All right, contract setup. Here's the next one here. Basically, this is the way the contract, it should be set up, okay? Now, some area offices and some area engineers do not want the contractor entering letters in there. They want the Corps to enter the letter, because if there's ever a problem with the letters or something like that, the Corps can then adjust them or do whatever. Now, this is one of the features that, like we're saying on SAMC, they're using, and we're getting all these letters, PDF, in the contract. So if you ever need a letter, you can go word search, letter search, whatever you want to do, and you can pull that exact letter out from the contractor. This is a great feature if you choose to use it, or your area engineer wants to use it. Some of them don't want it. Don't want to use it. They say, we will do it. That's your choice. But know the features there. Insurance and payrolls. For some reason, sometimes this gets set as government. For some reason, and I don't know why. You need to make sure and always change that to contractor. Because if you don't, they have read-only access to that. And that is their field. And that'll be a complaint. They're like, well, I can't do anything with that. Well, send them an export. Change it over to contractor. Send them an export. They'll have it. And then RFIs will be set to both. Right there. So then we could actually do a government RFI, and if you do a government RFI, it'll have a G on it. RFI number and a G versus the contractors is just it's a RFI number, whatever it is. So that allows us to do that. Another area here is this funding. And really you should not be ever messing with this area. This is something that should be set up for you prior to you getting involved. But some of the key elements here, and some of the problems we've had on these jobs down here is, okay, these are incremental funded jobs. How do we handle that? And some area engineers have chosen to handle it a way, and some have chosen, in other places, they're choosing to handle it other ways. If you have incremental funding, basically you should be in the second or the third track here, okay? You should not be in this first track. All right, because the first track says, this is the amount of money you got, and you're awarded this amount of money, okay? And if your contractor, like on, the one we had the biggest problem was the URS contract, MIF 1 and 2, over there. And basically, we stayed in the first track, and we said, okay, we only gave you $40 million. Well, we awarded the contract for $80 million, but we didn't have all the funding. So then it created admin mods and other stuff like that to increase funding. And one of the problems with that is now your contractor can't cost load his schedule fully for what the value of the contract is, because he can only balance to the clients. And if you have limited him to the $40 million, now you really messed them up. And they tried to simulate what was happening in El Paso and how they're doing in El Paso, which that's what they're doing in El Paso, except in El Paso, their contracts were set up differently. Their contracts were, you're going to get a contract for 3 barracks, and it's worth $20 million. And we have option 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 for the other barracks to equal the other $100 million. Okay? So as the money came, we awarded options and picked up those pieces. And that works perfect in that first system, because that contractor only had a $20 million contract. Granted, the first 3 barracks cost way more than the last ones did, because it was going to take him the full amount of time, no matter what. All his overhead was in the first 3 barracks versus being distributed over all of them. Because whether he built the other ones or not, he was still going to be on the job. So, but that's how that was handled. And down here, we tried to mimic that, but it's a different situation. This was truly incremental funding, and truly we should have been in the second one, where we said the award is this full amount, and then just send them the admin mod saying, okay, you got additional funding, you got additional funding. But talk with your area engineer and Butch, and like for San Antonio, you want to talk with Roger and those guys before this gets decided, and or Tom Bancroft. I mean, you can call up there, because he's helped deal with this, and we've had to fix lots of issues with these things. And, you know, call us as a resource up in the district, and we can definitely give you guidance there. All right, modifications. Basically, this is just who's titled on this stuff. One thing Butch will tell you is don't put the ACO's name in here, because in case that ACO is on leave that day or something like that and you need a mod signed, it's better to have the ACO go and write their name below their signature instead of having to do, because you can't do a four and that kind of stuff on mods. So look at that stuff. Quality assurance. This is actually a new feature in the system. Now it's showing that they're actually working 6 days a week here. Okay? So that affects your weather calendar calculation. Alright, now weather calendars, there's actually a new feature now that the project engineer can approve the weather delays monthly, and then it'll automatically generate a mod for you to do weather mods right off the bat. Okay? But what has to happen is that the QA's daily report for weather and the QC's daily report for weather have to match. Or the project engineer's got to make a decision as to which one's right or wrong in order to make that process work.
On this particular one, 5 day work week is the contract.
Yes.
6 day work week is what they've actually been working for the past month and plan on working for the next month at least.
Uh-huh.
Is that entered correct?
Yeah, no, that's
okay. Fine. And then, yeah. So 2 months down the road, if they go back to a 5 day work week, I go and change that.
Yes.
Will the weather mods still come out right?
It should.
Okay.
That's why the field's open.
Great.
There. Because see right here, anticipated adverse weather, it says 5 there. Mm-hmm. Anticipated adverse weather basis 4. 4 day, 5 day a week is only 4.
Okay.
So see, it's running a count for you.
And the contractor needs to change that in his QCS from the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Yeah.
So yeah. When I change that down the road, it won't affect past months, it'll only affect from this day forward?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. You know, is the contractor working 6 days a week because he wants to, or is he working 6 days a week because he has to make up schedule?
Because he needs to because of all the weather days.
That's not going to change the past ones, because once your mod's complete, it's not going to change.
Yeah, it's going to go back and change future ones.
Some people have left their mods completely open and not closed them. It will go back and change them, but if you marked it complete, it shouldn't change them at all.
Well, I'll bet he's probably not wanting weather days. That's why he's working Saturdays.
What you just said was he has to catch up on weather days he's had. Well, weather days he's had has already extended the CCD date. So
they have
already
extended. However, we don't want to extend it more.
Right.
Because
a lot of these contractors don't want weather days.
Yeah.
A lot of these contractors don't want them because guess what?
Over here.
It costs him money. Yeah, we're saying here's a free gift. You can extend your contract, but guess what? That costs him $2,000 or $3,000 a day for every extension day you get. Well, so he'll say, "Shoot, I'll work that up."
He's either paying for it by working an extra day, or paying for it at the end of the contract. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, and it's his choice.
Yeah,
it's his choice. Anyway, okay. The next one here is submittals and schedule. And this one's filled out. Looks like it's filled out right. This is a block that you have to fill in. It's not something the contractor can fill in. You have to put in, this is the review period days for all these types of submittals. Now, the contractor, and like I told them yesterday when I was talking with them, they need to give you a goal for a resubmittal period, because once we get into the submittals and items and all that stuff, they're supposed to link the submittals to the schedule. Well, that helps calculate that, having that date, that number of days stuck in there. So they need to tell you what that is, what their obligation is. Now, down here, in this area, the schedule option down here, you have two options. The first one says manually enter start and finish dates. That is only for these small little jobs where you don't maybe not have a scheduling spec requirement. If it's under $500,000, you can actually change that switch, and the contractor basically gets an Excel spreadsheet and his QCS at that point and can actually manually update that. It is a royal pain in the rear to do it that way. I've had Geico on our jobs in the past and give them a $50,000 job, reno job, to do some little thing, and they'll build a schedule for it because it's easier to process a pay than do this manual calculation. So, but if it's not in your contract, it's not in your contract. We can't require them to do it. But you need to know you got to switch that button if it's not in your contract. And he's not going to build a schedule. Otherwise, the system is expecting a schedule to be imported. Now, you see this next button down here. Do you want QCS to require the contractor to use actual start and finish dates from the QC reports on the NAS? That's a new feature, and I really like this one. Because, and I had HP actually called me on, I think it was this contract too. They were like, dude, what happened? I can't do my payout. It says I got all these dates that are wrong. I said, yeah, you know, your problem is your QC logged in and said this activity started on this day and it finished on this day. And then your superintendent and your project manager went in a vacuum over there and decided what days these activities started and finished and proposed that to our guys. We don't go back and validate that, but guess what? Now the system checks it. And it won't let them do a payout until they get it right. So that's a great new feature because that's an obligation that they have to make sure the QC report matches the schedule. Now, it also gave them a feature where they can print the actual starts and finishes. And if they realize that the daily report's wrong, you got to unlock it for them and send it back to them so they can fix it so then the daily report and the schedule match. Otherwise, there's no other out. There's no other out. That's your options. And actually, then you have to unlock two of them. Because you'll have to unlock the one that they said started so they can take it and say not started. And then unlock the one that he truly started on. So it creates some burden, but now it makes them honest.
Accountable.
It makes them be honest on that. And that's one of the things we fought for years because everybody gets in a hurry at payout time. So, man, I got to get this guy paid. I got to get this guy paid. And you see, here's all these changes came in from QCS on the schedule and say, actual start changes. Oh, you know, and the contractor, they're sad. They explain it like this. Well, yeah, because I didn't have an actual start. Now I do have an actual start. So that's why you're seeing the changes. Well, that's not true. It was changing the daily reports because it was coming in and it saw an error, but there was no way to stop it. And all we do, we get to that situation at payout time and say, oh, heck, that's just because they're putting actual dates in their approval. And I used to do the same thing when I worked for the contractor. I'd explain it the same way. That's why I know their excuse. But that's what it is. And so it makes them be honest with that. I would really like that. That's a new feature. I really like that. Okay, on this P2 project, Tommy?
You want to take 5?
Yeah, sure. If you want to take 5 minutes, we'll kick back up. And Tommy will talk about P2 projects and some of the other features.